scripture tonight is Mark 10, 13 to 16. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and he blessed them. It's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I know what you're thinking. Wow, short scripture.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you why. Actually, in the United Methodist, thank you. See, I need some help. The United Methodist Lectionary, the actual scripture reading should be Mark 10, 2 through 16. But the first part of that has to do with marriage, between the female and the male, what is a lawful marriage, what is it to be divorced, what do we call the woman after she becomes divorced, what happens to the man after he becomes divorced, and I thought, I'm not stepping into that Vietnam. I'm going to let the big guy handle that tomorrow morning. You want to see his sermon, go on to YouTube, you can check that out. I'll let smarter guys take care of that. But what I want to talk to you tonight is something that's near and dear to my heart, and that is children and communion. I've been a music teacher at Riverside for 18 years now, and I'm starting to realize something. I'm an old man. No, really, I'm an old man. Younger than some, but older than most. I am an old man. And I first started realizing that I'm an old man is because now I'm teaching children of the children I once had. And they come up and they pick up their kids and they stop and they look at me. And then they look at their kid and they go, "Is that Mr. Rice? Wow, what happened to him?" You know, he used to be my music teacher. Do you guys still sing the Riverside Fight song? We used to sing it on Fridays. You still do that too during closing announcements? Oh, I remember doing that. And this warms my heart because now I'm part of tradition. I am a memory now of one generation that gets to live it to the next generation. And that's not a bad gig, in my estimation. And being a music teacher, I had the luxury of not enduring state standardized testing, as some people have to. So I have the freedom and flexibility of pretty much teaching what I would like. And I get to teach about different cultures through songs and music history. One in particular that comes into mind is I teach my second graders a song about a rabbit. That this is a Japanese folk song, and this rabbit lives inside of the moon. And all year long, this rabbit pounds and twists rice into rice cakes. All year long. And then comes down on New Year's Eve and distributes these rice cakes to the children. And the kids look at me with kind of wide-eyed wonder and go, "Wow, that's really weird." And I say, "Well, yeah, it is kind of weird. Let me tell you about this other culture, though. There's this other culture that goes out, their kids, in the middle of the night, and they go from door to door wearing the most horrendous clothes, bloody and horrible, and they go and they bang on people's doors and threaten them. Can you believe that?" And they go, "Wow, who does that?" And I go, "You guys do." And they say, "What?" And I said, "October 31st, what do? They go, "We just go around and..." Oh, yeah. I guess that's kind of weird. We all have traditions in our lives, whether they're cultural or family. We all have them. Holiday traditions are probably the most and strongest that we all share, but we all have our different spin on them. That makes your Christmas your Christmas, or what makes your Thanksgiving, or your Easter. And we pass these traditions down from one generation to the next. Because I believe that sometimes in a cold, unfeeling world, that goes faster than sometimes we can keep up. This gives us a warm, safe place in our hearts and reminds us of those better days when we were kids. So how better to keep our traditions alive through the passing them down to our children, right? But sometimes our traditions are a bit boring for our children. One of our biggest family traditions is every year we go to Frankenmuth. And I like to go on Black Friday because I'm stupid. I like to go on Black Friday because it kicks off our fun old, good old-fashioned holiday tradition. However, dragging my kids for those first couple of years to Frankenmuth, I'm talking about all my kids. I'm talking about Jacob. I'm talking about Joey. I'm talking about Brady. I'm talking about Zane. I'm talking about all of them. Trying to drag them to Frankenmuth was like pulling teeth. But now Jacob cannot wait to go to Bronner's. He asked me in August, when are we going to go? He can't wait to go. Joey can't wait to see the Christmas decorations all around the town. And Brady can't wait to go to eat everything that isn't nailed down. I'm excited to say that this family tradition is growing. Because back in the sound booth this past Sunday, Zane was telling his girlfriend that on Black Friday we go to the Mooth. And she needs to come. Oh, what the heck? Let's have the whole praise team come on down. Oh, why not? The whole Saturday service, come on down. And if we cause too much trouble, where do we say what congregation are we from, Rick?
Grace.
Grace United Methodist, that's right. It's amazing how quick that came out. So you have a lot of explaining to do, Doc, when we get out of jail. In our scripture lesson today, Jesus is having a wonderful interaction with some children. And in rereading this scripture, I think about the children today and what we consider their acceptable church behavior. And sometimes we pigeonhole certain kids into a self-fulfilling prophecy as being a bad child. Let me illustrate this through a story. Two brothers who were always getting in trouble and not getting along. We'll just call them Jacob and Joe. No, I'm just kidding. It's really Jonathan and Andrew. No. Whenever something went wrong in their neighborhood, they were the first one to blame. And one day, finally, their parents asked the pastor to help. So the pastor decided to see them one at a time. He wanted to remind them that no matter where they were or what they were doing, God was with them and saw them. Well, the pastor met with the first brother. He pointed his finger to him and said, "Where is God?" The boy looked under the desk. The corners of the room. He looked out the window, but he said nothing. Finally, the pastor said again, "Where is God?" Well, the boy panicked, ran out the door and all the way home. Finding his brother, he drags him up to the bedroom, slams the door and says, "We are in big trouble." The brother says, "What do you mean, big trouble?" He stammered and replied, "God is missing, and they think we did it." What does this scripture tell us? It tells us to let the children go. Some parents wanted to bring their kids to Jesus. All parents want to bring their kids to Jesus. Isn't that a great desire? Don't you want the same for your kids, your grandkids? All of us parents want the kids to come. We want to see the truth, them to see the truth, and receive Jesus in their lives. The problem is there are many barriers for them to get to know Jesus. And sometimes the barriers can come inside of this church and other churches. In this passage, the disciples felt that Jesus had better things to do with his time than to hang out with a bunch of kids. Unfortunately, there are some churches, not this one, that I know of, that don't make their children's ministry a priority. And that they should. Jesus, it says in Scripture, was indignant. When he saw this, he wasn't just indignant, he was angry. And I am so happy that we have a church that honors and values our children and hopefully seeks to remove all the obstacles we can from having Jesus in their lives. So why is it so important for kids to get to know Jesus right away? That is because we only have a limited amount of years with our kids. Statistics show that people who do not receive Jesus Before they leave high school, probably never will. Probably 8 out of 10. And even after college and university study, that number grows higher, 9 out of 10. I know that some of you may have grown up in a place where you were expected to sit down, be quiet, do what you're told. But we should encourage our kids to be active participants. A preacher wanted to show off his garden to a man who wouldn't let children attend church. He wanted them to wait until they were old enough to decide for themselves. When they walked into his garden, it was full of weeds, which were choking the squash, they were choking the beans, they were choking the okra. The man said, "This is a pitiful excuse for a garden, Reverend." To which the preacher replied, "I just wanted to wait to see what the vegetables had a chance to decide for themselves what they wanted to do." There was a little old lady who was amazed at how nice the young man was next door. Every day he would help her gather the things from the car or help her around her yard. One day the old lady finally asked the young boy, "Son, how did you become such a fine young man?" And the young man replied, "Well, when I was a boy, I had a drug problem." The old lady was shocked. "I don't believe that." The young man replied, "It's true. My parents drug me to church on Sunday, on Saturday night, and every time there was a fellowship event, they drugged me." Parents, get your children to know Jesus no matter what it takes. Don't let anything come between them, not even yourselves. Let them come. Second of all, the scripture teaches us to learn from our children. Jesus said that the kingdom of God belongs to children such as these. Now, God does not want us to be children, but wants us to be like them. It is not the age, but the attitude that we're talking about. Children remind us of what it's like to have a childlike faith and a childlike dependence, and that's what it's all about. A certain man was walking his daughter to school, but she didn't know where she was going. He asked if she knew where she was going. She said, "No." And he said, "Are you scared?" And she said, "Of course not. I'm with you." Children remind us what it is to look at the world with wide-eyed wonder. They remind us of who we were when we were kids, before the world beat us down sometimes and made us cold and apathetic. I love working with kids because they're so open and honest. Sometimes a little too open and honest. But you always know where you stand. A minister was speaking to the Sunday school about things that money can't buy. It can't buy laughter, and it can't buy love, he told them. Driving his point home, he said, "What would you do if I offered you $1,000 not to love your mother and father?" Stunned silence came from the children. Finally, one small voice quivered as she raised her hand. "Well, how much would you give me not to love my big sister?" The third thing that the scripture tells us is to love children completely. It says that Jesus took the children in his arms, put his hands on them, and blessed them. What a great model for us to show love. How do you learn to love a child? You do what Jesus did. He took. Love means spending time with your kids. Jesus took time to spend with the children, and he made it a priority. He touched. Love means touching your kids. Jesus could have just waved and spoken to them from a distance and sent them on their way, but he didn't. It says he puts his hands on them. We need to make it a habit to physically touch our kids. A little 4-year-old girl became frightened late one night during a thunderstorm. After one particularly loud clap of thunder, she jumped up from her bed, ran down the hall, and burst into her parents' room. Jumping right into the middle of the bed, she sought her parents' arms for comfort and assurance. "Don't worry, honey," her father said, trying to calm her fears. "The Lord will protect you." The little girl snuggled closer to her daddy and said, "I know that, but right now I need somebody with skin on." blessed. Love means speaking truth to your kids. When it says Jesus blessed them, it means he spoke love into their hearts. When was the last time somebody really blessed you by speaking an encouraging word into your life? When was it the last time that you blessed your child by speaking love into their hearts? As a parent, sometimes I feel like the only time that I speak to my kids is when I'm trying to discipline them. But it needs to be a balance between an affirmation and affection. Today, we need to take this opportunity to bless a child. We have a lot of them. You have a lot of them. Be a mentor. Zane's still looking for him. Go see him. Be a mentor to a child. Bring your kids to Jesus by sharing the tradition of communion. The traditions of communion vary from church to church, place to place, culture to culture. Intinction, deliver to the pew. Eat the bread, take a shot. In Catholicism, sometimes the priest feeds us without us touching it because we're unworthy of holding the body of Christ, which I should have told my wife the first time that she came here to receive communion. You see, she got the bread, threw it in her mouth, went for the cup, and Gary Brody went. In which she went. Now, we all know the tradition of communion that we're going to celebrate today. Or do we? Where did we learn this tradition of communion? And what does it exactly mean? Well, if you look at communion from farther back and try to explain it to a person who's never heard it, or a child, it's a little grotesque, a little macabre. We're eating somebody's flesh, we're drinking their blood. Is this church? Is this the Walking Dead? Holy Communion is the Lord's Supper. It's sometimes called the Eucharist and other names. It is a rite considered by most Christian churches to be a sacrament. According to some New Testament books, it was instituted by Jesus during the Last Supper. Giving his disciples bread and wine during a Passover meal, Jesus commanded his followers to do this in memory of me, while referring to the bread as my body and the wine as my blood. Through the Eucharistic celebrations, Christians remember Christ's sacrifice of himself once and for all. But there comes a conflict of tradition. And this is where I get some theological heat with colleagues of mine, especially this one who happened to be Catholic. I told her about World Communion Weekend, and she was befuddled by the whole notion of this. Why isn't every Sunday World Communion Sunday? And I began to explain it to her in this way. Thank you, Wikipedia. Christians generally recognize the special presence of Christ in this rite, though many differ exactly how, where, and when Christ is present during this. While we all agree that there's no perceptible change in the elements, some believe that they actually become the body and blood of Christ, while others believe the true body and blood of Christ are really present within, with, and under the bread and wine, whose reality remains unchanged. And others, in a real but merely spiritual presence of Christ. And still others only view it as symbology, a reenactment of the Last Supper. Many Protestants view the Eucharist as an ordinance in which the ceremony is not seen as a specific channel of divine grace, but as an expression of faith and obedience to Christ. Now, I love this person. I just read all this stuff, too. And she glanced over like you guys are right now. And she'll remain nameless, this assistant principal who works in my building. But sometimes she comes across, not condescending, but a little, as my wife calls it, snarky. She said, if you don't believe it, becomes the body and blood of Christ, then why do it? And I said, because we do it in remembrance of him. But I told her, if she needs more information, I'll clarify it with the founder of my faith, John Wesley, and when I get to heaven, I'll get back to her. She then asked, well, what if you went to hell? I said, then you can ask him. Totally kidding. I didn't say that. That's what was going through my mind. I'm taping this for my people in my prayer group. I'm totally kidding, Suzanne. I mean, assistant principal. I mean, in spite of all this difference that we have in communion, what does it all mean? I don't know. But I do know this. This sacrament and celebration has been repeated over and over and over again in countless churches, homes, communities for more than a millennium. So whether you believe it is a consecrated practice or a spiritual reenactment, we can all agree that it is in remembrance of him. So when you receive the bread today and the wine, hold it with a childlike wonder. And know that you are participating in a ritual that God himself, in human flesh, asked us to do in remembrance of him. And don't worry about the taste on your tongue, whether it's Hawaiian or gluten-free, Welch's or Meyer brand grape juice, but how it fills our hearts in a moment that is being shared millions of times across the world. And how far away are we from those celebrating communion in hundreds of different countries? Well, I'll leave you with one of the final things my good friend Terry Powell said to me. We are no farther than across the table. What a tradition our pastors leave us as they come and go. One pastor ends a sermon with, "You're all a blessing."